I'll say that again, because the best portfolio is an undiversified portfolio when you're right. And so the problem is many of us think that we're right. and so we make these bets, you know, that's our ego. And so what I would say is that save 15% and then go place bets. Try to win the game. And I think you're going to serve yourself while doing that.
This is the Staying Power Podcast, a show that explores the challenges business owners face as they grow. I'm Brandon Hall.
And I'm Thomas Castelli.
And together, we ask the tough questions to show you that running a business is not for the faint of heart. But if you have staying power, you'll overcome your challenges and achieve lasting success.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for tuning into this week's episode of the Staying Power Podcast. Today, we're joined by Darryl Lyons, CEO of Pax Financial Group, author of Small Business Big Pressure, The Grand Money Chasm, and 8-18. And he's also a member of the Advisory Council for Dave Ramsey Solutions. Today, we discuss why Darryl left his prior firm to start Pax Financial Group, the secrets of internet marketing, financial and retirement planning for small business owners and real estate investors, and of course, the challenges Darryl faced as he grew his company, including hiring top talent and how a personal challenge made quitting an option at one point in his business. Darryl, thank you so much for taking the time to come on the show today. Would you be able to give our listeners a little information on your background?
Yeah, so Darryl Lyons. I grew up pretty much all in South Texas and lived in a little small town called Castroville, Texas, which is a really small kind of farm town right outside of the city of San Antonio. We lived in a little trailer park on the side of the road there. And I think it was just, I wanted to know how people had houses without wheels. Like that was my thing. Like, how do you have a house without wheels? And so I just became curious about money after, I mean, really at like 17, maybe 18. And it was just a curiosity. It wasn't like anything rooted in like ambition or being rich. I was just really curious. And so I went to college and worked at a bank, and that's how I paid my way through college. I got a degree in accounting, another one in finance, and just kept studying and wouldn't stop. I still study to this day. Money. It's interesting to me.
Can't fault you there. We love money too. Of course, being CPAs, we love money. So we understand you're the co-founder of Pax Financial Group. Would you be able to just tell us a little bit about what Pax Financial Group is and why you decided to start it?
Yeah, so Pax Financial Group, we're an RIA, registered investment advisory firm. We are not affiliated with a broker dealer. So I actually had the Series 7 and 63 licenses, 24 and a couple others, and I dropped them all. The regulatory environment under FINRA, I thought it was kind of counterintuitive to growing an entrepreneur type business. So we became a registered investment advisor. We dropped all of our licenses. We started PAX 13 years ago, me and two other guys. We were working for a larger Fortune 100 firm. And you just felt this disconnect between agendas, between the large firms and the consumers, you know, trying to sell products that may not be in the client's best interest. And you just kind of weighs on you after a little while. And so then we went and we decided to start our own RIA. One of the problems that we had a letter from corporate that came to me personally, and it said, you have a relationship with Dave Ramsey. We're huge Dave Ramsey fans. And so it said, you have a relationship with Dave Ramsey. You need to make a decision on whether or not you want to be associated with our firm or Dave Ramsey. And so that's when I walked in. I said, okay, I'd rather be associated with Dave Ramsey, and we resigned. And so today we have a great relationship with Dave Ramsey. I'm on his advisory council. I fly up there actually next week to visit with him and his team. And that he was really the tailwind that got us off the ground, because we were a part of something called the ELP program. So he sent us a bunch of leads, and we would just service these people. And they're like really, really good people, just with, you know, just good American values. And it was just fun meeting these people. I mean, it was just such a pleasure and a blessing. And so the three of us just kept rocking that. And then one of the three co-founders ended up working for Dave Ramsey. He actually moved to Nashville, and he took all of Dave Ramsey's content and translated into Spanish. His name's Andres Gutierrez. And so we bought him out. So then it was two co-founders still there. We added some other partners, some other pieces, and we just continued to grow. I think we made the Inc. 5000 list like 3 or 4 years in a row now, in growing and just trying to navigate the financial markets. You know, think about this, you know, when we started 2007 when we started. So that was like right kind of almost one of the worst times to start a business, in 2008, the market crash, and then all the other events that have taken place. But we've We've ended up weathering it pretty well. And now we have 1,400 households we serve. We help them with financial advice. We're their guides. And we have one other thing that's interesting, I think that's interesting, is we have a good relationship with Goldman Sachs. So Goldman Sachs is a very, you know, ultra high net worth firm. We signed an agreement with them to be able to access some of their tools, like their investment portfolios and some of their technology. And so we have this really interesting culture where we've got this high net worth solutions of Goldman Sachs relationships. And then we've got this heart of a teacher, middle America, Dave Ramsey relationship. So that's kind of, that defines us as a company. And so I spend most of my time providing leadership to the organization and strategic direction, things like that.
So thinking all the way back, why would corporate make you choose between them or Dave Ramsey?
Well, there was, I think it boiled down to a product. I think Dave Ramsey is allergic to whole life insurance. And he's made that clear on the radio. He calls it the pawn shop of the middle class. And, you know, Dave, he's a polarizing guy. Mm-hmm. And this company manufactured that product. I think they took offense to that. And so they just said, these are two different messages and we just don't want to have anything to do with it.
Got it. That makes a lot of sense. So it sounds like your firm kind of has two different demographics that you service. Is that, would you say that's accurate?
Yeah. It's really cool. I mean, we're trying to find the holy grail in our business because we don't have any minimums and we're committed to that. We want to figure out a way to serve a lot of people in a lot of different ways. So somebody just wants to come to us and start a Roth IRA. Cool. No problem. And then on the other end, we have the capabilities to serve people that have tens and millions of dollars to invest, which we do all the time. So it's kind of a mission for us to be able to serve a wide number of people in different ways. And the biggest puzzle piece is how to do that efficiently. And we're always talking about how to do it more efficiently and how do we redesign our people and systems and process and expectations to be able to serve all these demographics. And consultants come up to me all the time and say, oh, this is easy. If you want to be more profitable, just put a minimum in place and you'll be just fine. And I'm like, well, that's antithetical to what I want to do, which is be a place that anybody can come to and feel comfortable talking to somebody about money.
It's kind of interesting because a lot of the, like our philosophy and a lot of the other business owners that we talk to, we run into the same issue of, you know, you want to work with everyone, but your time is a very limited resource. So how do you do that efficiently? And typically what people do is they start niching down in a particular subgroup and you're trying not to do that. And it's an interesting conversation because our niche is real estate at the CPA firm. And we've experienced something similar where we have really large real estate clients, like $100 million type of syndicates and funds, really, really big sole owner investors that have just tons of assets. And then we also have these really small, brand new mom and pop landlord clients. Now, well, it's going to take me more time to service the hired guys, but on an hour by hour basis, it's more profitable to service the hired guys. So how do you maintain profitability while also getting this information to these lower level individuals? And something that we're actually experimenting with right now is launching a course on tax strategies for real estate investors. We're going through a pilot right now and it's working out really well. But that was something we had the same dilemma that you had where we had a niche, but even within the niche, there's such a wide range of people that are coming through and the clients and their capabilities and their financial positions. And we like, you know, we want to help everybody. And it pains us because we see these tax returns that these other CPAs are filing. We're just like, oh, it's so bad. how do we help you? But you're not going to pay me $5,000 to help you. So how can I help you? And and the course was the answer. And anyway, I don't know if you've ever thought about something like that, but it's kind of interesting.
Yeah, no, it's great. You're really on something there. I think it's great. A couple of little thoughts. First of all, one of the things I try to, as a philosophy, try to focus on not maximizing profit, but optimizing profit. And so that just attitude is important because that allows me to maintain that mission. Because there is, if my goal was to maximize profit, then that would, there'd be an easy solution there. So I try to optimize profit. The second thing is I actually did a course online. Oh man, I spent so much money. I hired a big producer. Flew to North Carolina. I mean, it was called Pivot Retirement Planning, and Pivot I trademarked. It was in my third book that I wrote. Really, just I thought it was great content. I mean, I nerd out on this stuff. Did a whole course on it. I think my mom and my aunt signed up for it. And that was it. And I mean, I thought, hey, look, I can provide all this financial advice to the consumer that can't hire me for $39.95, and they're going to love it. The problem is, consumers are typically not rational people in the fact that, and humans aren't, not just, you know, most people aren't. And, you know, where we might say, look, yeah, that's $39, but there's still this oxytocin that takes place when you're kneecap to kneecap in front of somebody and they're giving you advice eye to eye. And so my heart was in the right place to give them a video content, but I still think there's some more work to do to be able to do that through a webinar or some other platform. So we're always exploring it. We just haven't cracked that code yet.
Have you read .com Secrets?
No. Is it a good book? I'll write it down right now.
Yes.
Oh, it's a game changer. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Tom, well, I'm stealing your thunder though. I mean, this is Tom's thing. So he made me read .com Secrets and Expert Secrets. Expert Secrets is the next book after .com Secrets. And then Traffic Secrets is the third book. It's all written by Russell Brunson. Now, Russell Brunson is a marketer day in, day out. He has made hundreds of millions of dollars by focusing on one thing, and that's building a sales funnel. And he says, if you're doing anything other than building a sales funnel on your website by pushing your products or anything, you're completely wasting your time. And when I'm reading this book, it's like punching me in the mouth, you know, everything that I've been doing up until this point is only half of the battle. But what I'm hearing from you though, when you're talking about your book and this course and the webinars, you actually already have a lot of the tools in place. So I'd be really curious to see if you read .com Secrets, if you're able to build out a sales funnel, I would almost 100% guarantee you that you could sell that course to a lot more people. It goes through like building a value ladder, right? So what are your main services? That's kind of the middle of the value ladder. Now what's below that? Maybe it's a free book plus shipping. So you break even on the book. The whole purpose is to get people to buy that book and just learn who you are. The next step is the course, the cheap course, mind you, but then you have a more expensive course with a live Q&A and you do launches. And anyway, man, it's read that book because you'll realize you already have the books and stuff. Like Tom and I were talking, we're like, we need to write books to get that lower end value ladder in place so that we can funnel people up and into our higher end services and we can provide them with even more value.
Yeah, that's great. I'll check out that book. I am a book nut, so I'll have to grab that one.
Yeah, I mean, I truly believe that, you know, out of all the books I've ever read, I've read a lot of books and I feel like, you know, I say this a lot, but I mean, if I had to pick one trilogy that would change someone's life, it would be that. I swear to God, it would be that trilogy. Because if you, after reading those, you're like, wow, like you see the big picture. And like Brandon said, I think you have a lot of the pieces already in place. It's just like, if you read that book, it's all going to click and you will see like how to fill in the gaps and make it happen.
And since you're so tight with Dave Ramsey and his organization, you're probably going to be able to read these books and see exactly how he's applying the fundamentals that this book teaches. You're in a really cool position. Read those books because you might. Yeah. But anyway, what I liked about .com Secrets is I think that a lot of service professionals, especially, they have great products. I was just having this conversation with somebody else this week where I've got this great product, but I don't have enough people that are funneling through to service. I want to service the entire world because everybody needs to know this stuff. And that's where the .com secrets, the expert secrets, the traffic secrets come into play because it's all about funneling people into your pipeline, providing them with value at each stage. And then the ones that want more value, they keep going up. They keep going up. And eventually they come to your firm and they say, I actually want that one-on-one planning now. And so it's just about like creating that sort of system and then saying, okay, now I'm just going to turn it on and people are going to come in and funnel into it. So that's really cool, really cool books, really cool. Definitely read them. Definitely.
You know, I guess 5 years from now, when I'm on Joe Rogan's show talking about financial planning in the nation, I'll say, well, where did it all begin with? You know, like, well, these two guys asked me to be on the podcast. It turned me on this sales funnel idea. And ever since then, it took off.
Never know.
Yeah, there you go. I think though that people are like, I myself, I was pretty resistant to the idea. Tom was just telling me the other day, he's like, you remember back in 2018 where I was like telling you that we need to do a course and you shot the idea down and all that stuff? It's like, yeah, because you see all these marketers and you're just like, ah, it's a bunch of BS and I don't want that to tarnish my brand. I want to be the guy that you'd invite over for a Saturday dinner. But what I realized though is that that's just I don't know. It's limiting. It's a self-limiting belief that by you not going out to the market and trying to get people to funnel in and move up your value ladder, that you're doing them a disservice. I think what I've learned is that by going out to the market and trying to influence as many people as possible, you're actually helping everybody. Because if you do have a great product, you're getting it into their hands. And it's a weird, like, it sounds weird. It's weird to say, but it works. It
reminds me of the musician that says, I don't want to sell out to the man, right?
And yeah.
Right.
So switching gears just a little bit, I mean, we'll wrap that up. Everybody's listening, go read .com secrets, okay? But you won't regret it, I promise. And kind of shifting gears a little bit to the business, you know, I know you work with a few different demographics. What are the top maybe financial mistakes do you see your clients, you know, your average client make? Like, what are the biggest financial mistakes they make?
Yeah, I can probably talk about it relative to the four segments that we really cater to. So physicians are one of them. We work with a lot of physicians. And, you know, the physicians are just so busy. The problem in the physician space mainly is that they don't sit down with their spouse to talk about money together. And so we created a framework to where we get to hear the voice of the non-CFO spouse and make sure that they're on the same page with their values and priorities. So in each segment, I'll give you an issue. And one is in the physician segment, it's not sitting down with the spouse because of life so busy, taking the kids everywhere. The small business owner space, which we work a lot in, is not preparing for the transition very well. Sometimes a business owner client just said, hey, I sold my business. And we could have done some unique tax strategies, like you guys know, whether it's you know, gifting some equity prior to a donor advised fund to reduce their taxable income, or opportunity zone funds, or things that could really help reduce taxes. And so, you know, that would be another one. The third segment we work in is actually being in Texas. We have a lot of Christian clients. And so we've created portfolios specific to those that want to align their values with their investments. And so we've created some specific, unique models to be able to help them do that. So missing that is a problem in that segment. And the final segment is the soon to retiree client. And frankly, what happens is many times they just don't have a plan. And I mentioned it before, we have a specific plan for helping people retirement. It's called Pivot Retirement Planning that we've worked on for years and years. And it's a specific strategy to help people not outlive their income. And it's not a bunch of annuities or things like that. It's designing a plan around somebody's unique situation. Those are the problems that I see in each of those segments that we work in.
Makes a lot of sense. And I know you kind of mentioned retirement planning. Like, what is the biggest mistake you see of retirement planning? Because I think for some reason, whenever, at least when I think of financial planning, I default to thinking of retirement planning as being one of the key aspects of that. And there's like a lot of people out there doing all different types of stuff, trying to liquidate their 401ks, you know, put their IRAs in self-directed IRAs, all this different stuff. So I guess just my question is, what are the biggest mistakes you see when it comes to retirement planning specifically?
Yeah. So retirement plan specifically, interestingly enough, 87% of investment results are a direct result of the decisions you make. I know that sounds like, well, that's a no-brainer, right? The other ones are asset allocation, what you buy, real estate, you buy stocks, bonds, and then below there it goes to stock selection and then market timing. So that's kind of the order in terms of priority of what impacts your net worth and investments. It's the decisions that you make. So what we try to do is try to figure out ways to develop retirement strategies to help people get in front of their future self. For example, we know markets every 5 years are going to shake up. That's the average. It doesn't work out that clean. And so in the midst of the shakeup, the older you get, believe it or not, you start to do your flower beds and you're watching Fox News and you get a little bit more anxious than you did when you were busy with your kids, because your life depends on whether or not this market can hold up. So to get in front of that, we've got to set aside more cash than what we did before. So we usually set aside a year of cash on everybody's account if we can, because we know that if things get kind of dicey and we for some reason need to stop distributions from their portfolio because the market's going down and they would be eating their seed, we can do that and live off of the cash for a little while. And that peace of mind is worth a lot of money. And it doesn't send somebody, and this is real, doesn't send somebody to the doctor for high blood pressure. And so I think what the biggest mistake people make in retirement planning is not the consideration of enough cash set aside. And you can set aside cash within your IRA. You don't have to pull it out and make a taxable event. You can put it in your IRA and lock it from trading. You just have to make sure you either tell your custodian or your advisor, hey, lock this cash within my IRA. Don't trade it, because I want to have that buffer for market downturns.
Because you don't want to sell your assets during a downturn, like, and eat into your seed, like you said.
Yeah.
Kind of just a few more questions along those lines. Like, so that's like, as you head into retirement, that makes a ton of sense. So like, when you're saving for retirement, do you tend to be more along the lines of like dollar cost averaging into like an index fund portfolio? Or are you more along the lines of, do you think like specific stock selections, or like, is it more nuanced than that?
Yeah, it's, you know, ETFs, we use a lot of ETFs now. I mean, they're low cost, easy access, the performance numbers just, I mean, it's hard to beat the index. There's segments of the marketplace that, you know, even in the bond space, you've seen active funds, like, well, I can't say the specific ones, but there's been some active funds that have outperformed the indices over time, but it's not the norm now. Most of these funds are having a hard time. Most of the traditional mutual funds are having a hard time outperforming the ETFs, exchange traded funds, which is a basket of stocks that have very low expense ratios. We still like using those. We will add, what we do is we satellite things. So as you start to build up this ETF because you're dollar cost averaging, right, which is great. I can't believe how much wealth is built through 401ks. I mean, yes, it is freakish. And people don't even understand the power of saving long-term through 401ks because it's like out of sight, out of mind. It's unbelievable. I mean, there's so many millionaires out there because of 401ks and IRAs. And so that's just dollar cost average. Now, when you get that bucket built up kind of relatively big, then we do something like, okay, here's the core ETF strategies and we're going to spread it out and, you know, international and all that. And then we oftentimes will satellite it. That's what we call satellite. Put a satellite together of a stock basket of, you know, growth stocks, tech stocks, biblical responsible stocks, whatever we want to do, but just not enough to where, you know, that it doesn't risk your entire plan, but maybe just to lean into an area that we're comfortable with.
You know, that makes a lot of sense. And just want to kind of make a comment because I know we might have some real estate investors who are listening to this podcast. You know, we see a lot of investors, they get caught up in the rich dad, poor dad ecosystem. I don't know if you're familiar with that. And they think the 401ks are evil, Wall Street's the devil, and they want to go and liquidate their 401ks or IRAs. And they sometimes are paying somewhere between 30 or 50% in some cases on their 401ks. And then they're going and investing in properties that may not be always getting a return that they get in the 401k. So I guess the point I'm trying to make is, I think for all the real estate investors who might be listening, is just putting money into a 401k or to an IRA and just dollar cost averaging and letting the market do the work for you and not getting too fancy will eventually put you in a spot that you're going to have. I guess what I'm trying to say is that you're removing the risk, you're removing your ego from making wrong investment decisions and just putting money, basically saving money into a 401k and dollar cost averaging. You're going to be in a much better position than you are today by doing that. So I don't know if that makes sense, but I think there's too many real estate investors out there who just liquidate their accounts and try to go willy-nilly. But you made a great point saying that there's power in just dollar cost averaging out over a period of time.
Yeah, and real quick, if I may, Darryl, how much of a role does the ego play here?
Well, it plays a big role. And so if you look at my net worth is relatively good. You know, coming from a trailer park guy, I'm completely blown away. I can't believe I even landed where I'm at. And but most of my net worth is in my business, right? Not even in the securities that I use. I have a good bucket of securities, but most of it's in, and because I believe this to be true, the best portfolio is an undiversified portfolio when you're right. I'll say that again, because the best portfolio is an undiversified portfolio when you're right. And so the problem is many of us think that we're right. And so we make these bets on real estate, which is really a business in a lot of cases. We call it real estate. Many times it's a business. There's work to be done. Very rarely is it just out of sight, out of mind. But, you know, that's our ego. And so what I would say is that if you believe in yourself, then I would certainly encourage you to place bets there, but hedge it. For example, I'm from Cashville. So let's say we had a hardware store owner and he did everything right and he was really good at business. And he had the best employees, made $5,000, did checked all the box, good ROI, and he's about to sell his business. And Walmart moves in right next door, or Home Depot. He's toast. Like, he's got this hardware store, and all of a sudden, so life happens, and regulation happens, and health happens. And so, what I'm asking every business owner to do is save 15% of your gross income and set it aside. Just forget about the fees and 401ks. I'll make a case against any book that talks about fees. Fees have come down so much. I do 401ks. I don't make anything but jelly beans on it. It's not a good business because it's so small margins. So don't be afraid of the fees in the 401ks. They're in there, but everyone gets paid fairly. Probably I get paid too little, but save 15% and then go place bets. Try to win the game. And I think you're going to serve yourself while doing that.
This is exactly I keep saying that, but it is my philosophy. Look, I consider myself a real estate investor, like a lot of people probably, you know, kind of cross over to this podcast. And look, you know, I've made some good investment decisions on the real estate side. I've also made some so-so ones. So the way I look at it is this: I'm going to put 15%, right, into my 401k or IRA, take my ego out of the equation, let the market do the work for me, because I know the market, unless the US economy or the US blows up pretty much and capitalism goes kaput, chances are there's a high probability of the market being higher in 30 years from now than it is today. So I know that's a relatively safe bet, and I'm willing to accept the perceived lower returns on that bucket of cash for the safety and security it's going to get me, knowing that when I hit 65, 70, I'm not going to be living hand to mouth, because I can go bet all my money on real, the rest of my money on real estate, but I can make a lot of mistakes along the way and potentially even lose it all. And I don't want to be 70 years old having to, you know, work at Stop and Shop ringing the register.
Yeah, exactly. And it's just prudent advice. And so I have to deal with that all the time with my friends and, you know, clients over the years. And I just want to be practical because I'm in the same position. I know there's places that I believe in, and I want to place bets, and I believe in myself, and that's the American dream. So I'm not going to stop you, but just let's put a little money aside. Let's just be prudent.
100%. So kind of just shifting gears a little bit again to your business, PAX Financial, you know, as you, you know, kind of grew the business over the last 13 years or so, what were the biggest challenges you faced in actually growing the business itself?
You know, we face these challenges. We face these challenges from the beginning. We face them today. And that's getting people in the right roles. You know, when we first started, you know, I looked at an intern. I go, hey, man, I need you to be my compliance guy. He's like, I don't know how to do that. I go, I know, but like, I don't have a compliance person and you're the only guy standing now. So the biggest challenge was trying to be honest with yourself and saying, these people got me here, but they might not be in the same role necessary to get us there. I mean, think how challenging that is. Somebody raised their head and said, I'm a compliance person, when we had hardly any assets. And then all of a sudden we move up higher to, you know, more complexity and more systems and processes and scrutiny. And that person may not be perfectly aligned with that role. And so then you have to come to that person and say, hey, look, you were good. You've served us well, but now we have to move you to a different role. Those are the biggest challenges because the skill sets change and the complexity of the business change. So even myself, I this is what I tell my team. I say, look, we're only going to be as good as the team here. I mean, and unless you guys get better, and myself included, we're going to have to hire more talent. So I'm always having to challenge myself and saying, are my skill sets equipped at this level and the next level we're going to? So the biggest challenge is making sure that we always are keeping a high level of talent in each seat, from the CEO and my seat to everyone else, the advisors to the chief operations officers to the sales manager, everyone, high talent people as we grow and then shifting accordingly. And that's just a constant game.
What does your hiring process look like in terms of, I mean, not too granular, but how selective, I guess, are you when you make a hire?
Well, one of the things that's different about us is we don't pay our advisors commissions or anything like that. So we pay all of our advisors salary. We think it's just there's better alignment with the consumer. We give them incentives because we want them to build a book of business. But we as a company, PAX, are putting ourselves out on the line by paying somebody a pretty decent salary to come on board. So that means we've got to be selective. And a traditional wirehouse firm, they just hire 10 people and see who sticks because they're paying them commissions, right? And there's no risk on their part. Alternatively, for us, when we look for an advisor, we are looking for people with technical expertise. So somebody who's been in this, typically a CFP is what we're looking for, a certified financial planner. And then we've got to make sure they align with our values, which we have some specific values that are important to us and a culture. And if there's a value alignment and the other character qualities, and then of course we have to be very careful because we can't overextend our overhead. So we'll hire them. And so we try to hire about 2 or 3 new advisors a year. And that's how we grow our distribution.
And what does your onboarding process look like for your new advisors? How do you get them up to speed, and how do you kind of teach them the culture and what you're about? Because, you know, they're looking at a bunch of other firms that don't necessarily share your same values. So how do you like really hammer it home for them, and over what period of time?
Yeah. So we do take quite a bit of time, several months, to get somebody on board. First, they have to read all my books. The reason is because a lot of who we are is in those books. They have to go through Financial Peace University, Dave Ramsey's program. So that's necessary. And then we have to do, for some of the candidates, we do get spousal dinners to make sure that their spouse isn't crazy. And then we spend about 3 months in a training process specific to that role. And then we do peer reviews. So it's every month, I believe it's every month now, we do peer reviews where we have a specific process where we get in a room and we ask, okay, how's this person doing? That person's in the room, by the way. What do you need to start? What do you need to stop? What do you need to continue? And then any deltas, and then just make sure there's a high touch. So there's no misunderstanding and somebody doesn't drift into an area of incompetency. So it's a very, very high touch, 30 to 60 to, I guess, 90 day onboarding. A lot of peer reviews in that, you know, 360 reviews, everyone, you know, from supervisor to coworker to even, you know, people working under that person that will be in that room.
Was there any times when that didn't occur that made you ultimately put that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We've missed on so many people. Oh, my gosh. The problem with me is I'm the worst hire because I believe in people. So I'm like, okay, yeah, I know that you stole money at Merrill Lynch. I get that. But I believe in you. Come on board and I'll change you. And, you know, I'm just an idiot when it comes to hiring because I believe in people so much and their potential and that I miss all of the blind spots. So what's the first thing that I did to get my arms around this is I got myself out of that hiring process. We hired people I don't even know anymore. Like we hired, you know, one person, two people just recently. I didn't meet them until they came on board. I just got out of the way. I was the biggest hindrance because I just see the best in people. I'm so blind to that. And that's a good thing for me in a lot of ways. But not in the hiring process is really bad. And so we hired a lot of potential that failed. And so that was the result of that. And, you know, I was a recruiter for a big company too, a big company that would just throw stuff against the wall without any consequences. And so that was the habits I had created. And I just had to get out of the way.
I hear you. I know I was a recruiter too for a while. And I know some of our clients that we used to work with get really, really, like they just really drill down into specific like who they wanted. Like I remember like there's times when like we'd send a lot of people to certain clients and like they had to go through like 20 people, 30 people in some cases to find who they were really looking for. So, I mean, I guess the point I'm trying to make with that is just like, sometimes it's like, it's not always the first people who come through the door who are always going to be the best fits. I guess
I was going to say we do have a lot of resumes that come in that we pass over and, you know, we're also reevaluating ourselves. You know, everyone's asked themselves in this, you know, with the craziness of the racist rhetoric that's gone around on, you know, diversity and stuff. And so we've had to take inventory of that too and say, you know, are the way that we're hiring people not opening the doors for people of minority? And I think there's room to work there too. You know, we have, I would say our workforce is diverse in terms of Hispanic, even Asian and females. But in terms of African-American, it's been really, you know, we looked at ourselves and we asked ourselves why, and there's some real industry challenges that have to be overcome there. So that's been a topic of conversation as well. So we've gone a little deeper there to see if, you know, if there's anything that any blind, I'd say mainly blind spots that we might have.
Yeah. So, you know, one question we ask everybody who pretty much comes on this show, was there a particular challenge? You know, the reason why we started the Staying Power podcast is to show people that business ownership is not all the glitz and glamour you see on TV with the Ferraris and, you know, vacations to Turks and Caicos. But there's actually some very difficult challenges and very difficult periods of times in people's lives that they go through as a business owner. And was there a particular challenge that you faced that was just so treacherous, so difficult that you're like, you know what, business ownership is not for me. I'm just going to go back to a safe W-2 job and just call it a day.
Yeah. There was more than a handful. One in particular was, I remember I was just getting a little older. I mean, not really that old, but I thought quite an athlete, but you know, I felt like, you know, I was playing football and basketball, I'd play recreationally and things were hurting a little bit more. So I was like, okay, well, I'm gonna go pick up golf, and I'm not really good at golf either. So I was just trying to find myself, just a weird little, you know, thing in your head as you get a little older. And then at the same time, my client called and I lost him $10,000. I just pushed the wrong button. The money was gone. I might as well burnt it all. It'd been funner. And he was mad. He had a beard and guns. And I was like, man, this is just like a bad week. I'm, you know, my head's trying to figure things out. And then it's like, okay, well, I'm going to just chill at my home. And it was a beautiful February day. I'll never forget because I rolled down the windows to take my daughter to the grocery store right up the road from us. And my wife was pregnant at the time with our third baby. So I said, you know, I'm just going to head up and get some groceries for our family. And so I went up there and the windows were down. And then all of a sudden she screams, my 2-year-old in her princess dress, she screams. And what she had done is she kicked the up button the electronic up button with her foot and had her finger in the window and it was stuck. So I swerved over to the McDonald's parking lot. I thought I was going to have to punch down the window, but she let go. It came down, but her finger was severed and there's blood all over her dress. So I rushed to the hospital. They successfully attached it, but not without pain, of course, kept her there overnight, but my wife lost the baby. And so we had this like whole series of just, because what happens is it's not just business, like everything intersects. And so it's business, it's you growing as a person, and then it's family. And sometimes all of that collides at once and you just kind of get overwhelmed. That's kind of what happened to me. I just felt like really just inadequate. And that's not an uncommon, you know, place for me to go is like, man, I'm just not adequate to be a husband, to be a father. This is just not working. And so I just had to spend some time in just reflection, and quitting was a possibility, but it was just really numbness more than anything. And frankly, I found a guy that was a little older than me that had gone through life, and he mentored me, and he I reset myself spiritually. And that was really just a defining moment for me, because I think I was just frankly putting a lot of pressure on me to be perfect and do everything right. And by making that reset spiritually, that pressure went away. And so that's been my cadence since then, is to lean into my faith. And that was transformational for me.
Wow. That's a lot. That's a big story. And I'm sorry that you went through all of that. Now where we're at today, if you were to go back in time and be able to tell yourself something as you're going through that, what are you going to tell yourself?
That's really, really easy to answer, actually. And that's, don't worry as much. Do what you can control and not worry about everything else. And I mean, it's hard. I mean, but really, if I could just not worry, I mean, just things just kind of worked out. They never work out exactly as planned, but just do what you can, do the right thing, work hard, you know, all those things, but just don't worry. When you come home, just, you don't have to worry or stay up at night and just, you know, be stressed. And so that's what I would tell myself.
That's great. And I wish that more people would tell themselves that too. And I wish that I would tell myself that. I'm sure my wife would wish that I also tell myself that. Don't worry, it'll be okay. Because I think that aside from the personal side too, I think that in business, when you have an issue blow up in your face, you get so zoned into it that you just think it's the end of the world. Oh, this client's so mad at me and they're going to go tell the entire world and nobody will ever want to do business with me again. And that's such an emotional reaction. You just have to realize that at the end of the day, business is business. It will go on. It will be okay. And don't worry. At the beginning of the COVID breakout and the pandemic, when everything was shutting down, I was worrying consistently about how my business would be affected, as I'm sure many business owners were. And my business coach, who is much further ahead with the scale of his business than we are, I called him up and he was just like, listen, just sit down, spend a couple hours, write out a plan, put all your numbers on there and put certain benchmarks. And when you hit a benchmark, meaning that if your revenue declines a certain amount, then as part of your planning over this couple of hours, write down what you're going to do and what actions you're going to take. And now you get the emotional piece completely out of the picture, focus on the logic. But again, by doing that, you kind of step back, you look at it and go, cool, now I don't have to worry. Now it's just up to how well I can market, how well I can sell. Obviously, I don't want to follow this plan. But if this plan has to be executed, I've already built it out on the front end. So I don't have to spend my time anymore worrying about what will I do. I've got that. That's right there. It's right in front of me.
It's great that you mentioned that, because that's kind of what I do for a living, right? Is I help people build out the plan so they don't worry. and that's just a beautiful picture and illustration of kind of the job that I do. That and it's really purposeful in a lot of ways for me.
Good stuff. So if there's anything that you had, if you're looking back on your journey, is there anything that you would, if you had to do it all over again, is there anything you would have done differently?
Yeah, you know, you kind of think about that from time to time, but then you think, man, if I would have done it this way, then it would have turned out differently. For example, like when I first graduated college, my number one goal was to be in finance somehow, financial services, typically I wanted to be a certified financial planner. I was pretty focused on that. But my number one goal was to find a mentor. Like that was like, I didn't even know how to really tie a tie. So I needed to find somebody who could mentor me. So I did that. The guy was a schmuck. I mean, he he was just a guy that cheated and lied. And I reflect on that. I was like, man, I kind of messed up that mentoring thing. And then I messed up the mentoring thing again. I picked the wrong guy. Again, I guess there's a pattern in me picking people the wrong way. I got better with my wife. I promise you guys that. But early in life, I could have picked better mentors. But here's the thing about it. I learned so much from their mistakes. Like, man, this guy, he chased the almighty dollar. He lost his family. The guy can't keep a job to save his life now. His priorities were in the completely wrong place. I felt like the Lord was just kind of giving me an image of what not to do. And so, he didn't mentor me the way he needed to, but I still got what I needed. So that's kind of the way I look at it is, if I could, you know, kind of go back, I might find a better mentor, but would I have that same experience that guides that's my ethos now.
Good story. Mentor is definitely important. And like you said, sometimes you look back on stuff and you're like, you know, I could have done this differently, but then to your point, you wouldn't be where you are today. So everything kind of falls into place and kind of seemingly happens for a reason, I guess.
Yeah.
So what's the best place for our listeners to learn more about you, what you have going on?
Yeah. So you can go to paxfinancialgroup.com. That's PAX, Paul Apple X-ray, paxfinancialgroup.com. If your community can find me on LinkedIn too, I'm there too. I usually accept requests. But I guess if you're a digital marketer, I typically don't, because there's like 1,000 digital marketers that ping me a day. But outside of that, I typically take your requests. So you can find me there. And then all the books are on Amazon. I think for business owner clients, the one small business, big pressure, that might be a good one that kind of outlines how to run a business, some of the things that we've done. And then if you want to know more about your personal money, it's 18 to 80, everything you need to know about your money from age 18 to age 80. That's another good one. So both on Amazon.
You're going to have to check those out because they definitely seem interesting. Awesome. Thank you so much for taking the time to come on the show today. It was an excellent episode and I think learned a lot.
I hope it was helpful. I appreciate you guys just being engaging, and it was more conversational to me than anything. So thank you.